Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs class. So today you will have the daily current affairs, the class for the 7th of January 2021. And we are basically going to cover the daily current affairs news analysis. Here I am referring the two national newspapers. The first is The Hindu and the second is Indian Express. All right, so you can refer any of these newspapers, either The Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer both of them or you can read one of them also. But you should read one of these newspapers for your competitive examinations, like civil services examinations conducted by the UPSC. All right, so let's begin with the daily current affairs class. All right. So the first news, which is related to the Memoranda of Cooperation, so that is MOC, on specified skilled workers, right? So as the name itself suggests, it is a memoranda of cooperation. So first of all, it's a memoranda based on which certain set of decisions will be taken by the government, right? So this is basically a memoranda of cooperation which is signed between the government of India and the government of Japan, right? So here the memoranda of cooperation was signed and it is a basic framework for the partnership, right? For the cooperation, right, related to the specified skilled workers. So first of all, you must understand it is a memoranda of cooperation for the partnership of the skilled, specified skilled workers, which will be, right, which will be either India or the Japan, both countries will be able to send their skilled workers to either of these countries. So it is based on that partnership agreement where the two countries will be able to send their the skilled workers for work, for the work, right? So this is based on the specified skilled workers. All right. So this basically the memoranda of cooperation is basically an institutional mechanism, right? It is an institutional mechanism of partnership and the cooperation between these two countries, between India and the Japan, right? And here, as I told you, the both of these countries will be able to send their the skilled workers to work in each other's countries, right? But for sending, for example, if the Indian, you know, skilled workers would like to work in the Japan, they would have to qualify certain skill test, right? So that skill test will be required and the Japanese language test also will be required, right? So you need to qualify that skill test and the Japanese language test before you will be allowed to work in the Japan, right? And as I told you that it is a specified skilled workers. Specified means it is a specified, you know, in specified sectors, only some specified sectors the workers would be allowed, right, to work in each other's countries. All right. And here the government of Japan has decided to grant a new status of residence, right, which is of for the specified skilled workers. So this new status of the residence will be provided to the people who basically moved from India to Japan, right? And this would be a greater help, right, for those people who basically moved to the Japan. And how would be the implementation strategy? The implementation strategy for any type of memoranda of cooperation, right? The implementation strategy would be the formation of any sort of a working group, right? So here again, the government of Japan and the government of India, both of these countries would be forming the joint working group, right? So this joint working group would basically follow up any sort of a implementation program regarding this memoranda of cooperation between the India and the Japan, between the India and the Japan. And what would be the impact? You can visualize the impact. The first greater impact between the two countries would be the people-to-people contact. Obviously, when the people would move, right, to each other's country, the contact or the people-to-people contact would definitely increase, and that will further, you know, strengthen the linkages between India and the Japan. The second most important point is the industrial development, right? Because here you must understand the skilled workers would be allowed to move, right, which would allow the demographic dividend of India. So India has the percentage of the people in the working age, which is the higher side. But the Japan, which is, you know, aging because of longevity and because of low birth rate, right? So because of this, you know, the deficit in terms of the working professionals in the Japan, which will be filled, right, from the people which move from India or any developing countries. So ultimately, that will boost the production capacity of the Japan, right? Because these professionals, in terms of the manpower, would be moving from India to Japan for the work, isn't it? And there some professionals would be helping the Japan for overall development. All right. So this would be having the greater impact on the overall development, right, of the Japan as well as for the India. What would be the benefit for the India? The benefit for the India in terms of repatriation, right? The people who would be working in the Japan would be sending the money, right, to back to the India. So that will help the India in terms of the money which will be used for the developmental perspective. So both of the countries would be equally benefited out of it, and it will definitely enhance the development of both of these countries, right, in this framework. So obviously, by this memorandum of cooperation, the bilateral relationship between India and the Japan also will be boosted. So that will also smoothen the India-Japan relationship on every front, because here the people-to-people cooperation would enhance the movement of the people, isn't it? All right. So here the figure of the Japan, you can see here, this is the Japan. So these are basically the islands. So Japan is basically nothing but an island country. So here you see here the Kyushu Island, which belongs to the Japan, Shikoku Island, which also belongs to the Japan, Osaka, Nagoya, Tokyo, Yokohama, right? Honshu, Hokkaido. These are the parts of the Japan, right? Here you can say it is a Sea of Japan or East Sea, right? Here you can see it is, you know, the North Korea, South Korea, the China and the Russian territory. And here you have the North Pacific Ocean. So it is basically a political map of the Japan and adjoining territories. All right. So let's move to our the second news. All right. So let's understand the second news, which is related to the Chatargala Tunnel, right? So this Chatargala Tunnel, first of all, you must understand, it will be built. It will be built in the Jammu and Kashmir, right? So this tunnel, it is a proposed tunnel, first of all. This proposed tunnel would be named as the Chatargala Tunnel, right? So this tunnel is proposed to be built in the Jammu and Kashmir. So here, the news which is flashing is that the Director General of Border Road Organization, right? There is an organization called Border Road Organization, which is a responsibility of the maintaining and the constructions of the roads and the infrastructure, right, nearby the border areas. So the Director General of Border Road Organization, who is also named Lieutenant General Rajiv Chaudhary, basically briefed, right, the government of India about this tunnel, which is also known as the Chatargala Tunnel. So this proposed tunnel basically would be built in the Jammu and Kashmir. All right. And this tunnel would connect the Kathua district with the Doda district. All right. So that will basically, you know, pass and route highway via Vasholi Bani through the Chatargala to touch basically Bandharva and the Doda district of Jammu and Kashmir. So that will definitely connect. That will definitely boost the connectivity in Jammu and Kashmir, and that will also have the strategic impact on the faster movement of the security forces if there is need. And it is going to be an historic landmark project. Because why it is a historic landmark project? Because it will provide the all-weather road connectivity. Okay, so all-weather road connectivity means, because you must understand, during heavy snowfall, the connectivity of the out, you know, exterior locations of the Jammu and Kashmir will be snapped because of the heavy snowfall. Now, by constructing this road, definitely it will enhance, you know, the connectivity of far-flung areas, right? And it will also enhance the connectivity between these two regions, which is also known as Kathua and this Doda districts. All right. And it will definitely also reduce the travel time, because it will reduce, first of all, the distance. So in that proportion, it will also reduce the travel time also, right? And it will be 6.8 kilometers long tunnel, right? And if, you know, this tunnel would be constructed, right, it will take around 4 years to complete, right, this work from the date of constructions, from the date of construction. And the financial implication of this tunnel is 3,000 crore. So this would be, you know, the Chatargal Canal. First of all, this tunnel has the greater impact on India's, you know, interior security as well as the external security. So what will be the impact? First of all, you must understand the Jammu and Kashmir would be more integrated with the mainland India. The second is that the strategic benefit this tunnel would be providing to India. Okay, the strategic benefit in terms of, because if tunnel, you know, this tunnel would be constructed, all weather roads would also be constructed, all right. And it would allow the speeder movement or the faster movement of the security forces to move from you know, one location in the Jammu and Kashmir to the another location. And it will also, connect these two locations with all weather highway, with all weather road, all right. And once proposed, it will take around, you know, 4 years to be constructed completely, because it will take a time, because it is a tunnel, it is not a normal road. So a lot of excavation work is needed, and lot of, you know, the work which is needed to cutting down, to remove, you know, the different type of boulders which will be there in between. And it will also have huge financial implications, like 3,000 crore rupees will be invested in order to construct this tunnel, which is known as the Chatargal Tunnel. All right. So let's move to the new news. So it will be a tunnel just like this. All right. Let's move to the new news, which is Udyog Manthan. Udyog Manthan. So here you must understand, what is this Udyog Manthan? So it is name as suggest, it is a manthan. Manthan means it is a marathon which will be focused on, you know, the marathon which will be focused on some sort of a webinars. Some sort of a webinars, like the sector specific webinars will be there. Right, these sector specific webinars would be, you know, would be there for promoting the quality and the productivity of the Indian industry. All right, so here you will have some sort of a, you know, the videos, right, which will be provided through the webinars, right, which will be ultimately, you know, boosting the quality and the productivity in the Indian industry. So here, for doing this, a marathon is to be, you know, started. For that, the Department of Promotion in the Industry, which is also known as DIPP, right? Department of Promotion in the Industry and Industrial Trade, Internal Trade, under Ministry of Commerce and the Industry, Government of India, organizing this Udyog Manthan, right? So this Udyog Manthan, which is a marathon, is also associated with the Quality Council of India, right? As well as the National Productivity Council, as well as with the other industrial bodies, right? To produce the quality, you know, webinars for promoting this, the quality and the productivity in Indian industry. All right. And this webinar or this Udyog Manthan will be held from the January 4, 2021 to March 2, 2021. So it will have around the tenure of, say, it will have the time of around, you know, the 2 months. So for the 2 months, the webinars will be conducted. So there you will have the webinar series, right? So there you will have the webinar series. It will have around 45 sessions, right? These 45 sessions will be covering the major issues. As I told you, the main purpose of these webinars is to promote the quality and the productivity in the Indian industry. So how would you promote? How would you promote this quality? All right. So here you will have the webinar series. Here you will have the webinar series. The series will be having around 45 such sessions. Right, and through this 45 such sessions, various sector specific, right, in terms of the manufacturing, in terms of the services, right, some sort of a lectures will be provided, right. And here you will have, you know, the marathon where lot of other, you know, the experts also will be sitting. And through this Udyog Marathon, you will be having some sort of a, you know, identification of those challenges, the opportunities, and the solutions and the best practices which will be identified through this 45 sessions. So as I told you, you will have the different type of experts will be sitting in this marathon, right? So here you will have the representatives of the industries. Here you will have the representatives from the testing and the standardization bodies. All right. So you will have the different representatives from industry, testing and the standardization, these discussions will be held under this Udyog Manthan would be ultimately streamed or would be streamed on the YouTube, right? For those people who are also interested in these following, you know, sessions. So ultimately, the Udyog Manthan would be, you know, basically a marathon where you will have the representatives from the industry, testing industry, standardization bodies. The ultimate purpose of the Udyog Manthan is basically, right, is basically to boost or to promote the quality and the productivity in Indian industry, right? And how would you enhance the quality and the productivity in the Indian industry, right? The government of India through the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, the government has decided to launch a webinar series, right? This webinar series would consist of 45 sessions, and in these sessions would be attended by the participants. These participants are nothing but the representatives of industry testing and standardization that will basically definitely, you know, would brainstorm and discuss on various topics on various sectors in the manufacturing and the services. And that will also, you know, the identifying those challenges, those opportunities, and that will definitely draw upon the different solutions, right? And the best practices that are that can be implemented, right, in the Indian context, right? So this is basically the Udyog Manthan. So as I told you that this marathon is basically the webinar series, which will be promoting the quality and the productivity of Indian industries, right? And here you will have the 27 champion sectors and 24 subsectors, which will be integrated, which will be provided the greater insights. And it will definitely promote the quality and the productivity in the Indian industry, right? It will be mainly focusing on the manufacturing and the service sectors, isn't it? And you will have the domain expert-led panel discussions, right? The domain expert-led panel discussions means you will have the representations from the industry, right? And those experts will be providing their views regarding the challenges regarding, you know, the opportunities which are lying basically with, you know, with the industrial development. All right. And here you will have, you know, those webinars which will be live on, you know, on the YouTube, right? And those people who are interested can also, can also listen to those, the webinar lectures. All right. So this is basically, you know, a webinar series led the marathon, which will be attended by the representatives of industries, to ultimate purpose was to increase the quality and the productivity of Indian industry. All right, let's understand the new news. That is the CPI centralized network lab at DBT THRC Faridabad. So first of all, it is a lab, right, which is nothing but the CEPI means here, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations. So it is basically the coalition for the Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, right? So this coalition led the centralized network lab, right, which set up at this institute, which is known as the Transitional Health Science and Technology Institute, Faridabad, right? So this lab would be set up at this institute. So this is the news which is basically flashing, that the Union Minister of Science and Technology inaugurated, right? The Union Minister of Science and Technology is basically Dr. Harshvardhan. He basically inaugurated one of the seven labs of the world, which are called the Centralized Network Lab of Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations. This lab was established at this institute, which is known as THSTI Faridabad, so which is also known as Transitional Health Science and Technology Institute. So here you must understand, a lab was set up at the institute in the Faridabad, which is a centralized network lab, right? It is one among the seven labs of the world, right? So which one among the seven labs which would be set up in India? And here, this centralized network lab of Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation established this lab in Faridabad, right? So here, the CPI centralized laboratory at the TH STI Institute Faridabad is the first of its kind lab which is set up in India, and it is one of the 7 labs in the world only, right? So here you must understand, it is an institute, right, of the Department of Biotechnology. So this is Transitional Health Science and Technology Institute. It is basically an institute under Department of Biotechnology, and it is the only such lab in India, and it will be accredited by the National Accreditation Board for testing and the calibration laboratories, right? And you must also understand, the Coalition for the Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, right, is basically a partnership, right, between the public sector, between the private sector, between the philanthropic, you know, people, between the civil organizations, which was basically launched in 2017, right? Ultimate purpose was to develop the vaccine to stop the future epidemics. So one of the main purpose for this lab is also to develop the vaccines, right, for stopping the future epidemics like COVID-19. So I hope the news will be clear. The news is related to the lab which is basically going to be established at the Faridabad, the institute called the Transitional Health Science and Technology Institute at Faridabad. This lab would be the centralized network lab of the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, and it is one among the 7 labs in the world, right? This would be one such lab in the world which will ultimate purpose was to develop the vaccine to stop such future epidemics like COVID-19. And this institute is basically, you know, an institute under Department of Biotechnology. And here you must understand, the CEPI basically a coalition which will be having the partnership from the public, private, philanthropic and the civil organizations. All right. Now, the Department of Biotechnology, which comes basically in the Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, is implementing the India CEPI mission, which is titled as India-centric epidemic preparedness through the rapid vaccine development, right? Supporting the Indian vaccine development aligned with the global initiatives of the Coalition of Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, that is called CEPI. So here you must understand, the Department of Biotechnology basically implementing this mission, which is known as the India-centric, you know, the epidemic preparedness mission, which is also known as India CEPI mission. And here it will be, you know, helping the rapid vaccine development, right? And this would be supporting the Indian vaccine development with, you know, some sort of association with the global initiatives of the Coalition for the Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, which is also known as CEPI. Right. And this India CEPI mission is ultimate aim is to strengthen the development of the vaccine, because the ultimate purpose for the CEPI is to develop the vaccine to stop the future future, you know, epidemics just like a COVID-19. So ultimate purpose was to strengthen the developmental process for the vaccine development, right, to stop this epidemic potential, or to stop the disease like COVID-19 in India, right? As well as if we'll also have certain set of coordinated preparedness, right, in the Indian health system and the vaccine industries, right, so that any sort of a, you know, the need can be fulfilled, and it will also, you know, fulfill, you know, the mandate of the development of the vaccine in the near future also. All right, so it is the India's first the CEPI centralized laboratory, which is basically set up, right, at Faridabad, which is set up at the Department of Biotechnology Transitional Health Science and Technological Institute at Faridabad, right? So it is basically India's first CEPI centralized laboratory was set up by a, you know, video conference on the January 5, 2021. By Dr. Harshvardhan, who is also the Minister of Science and Technology. All right. Next news is related to the bird flu. Okay. So this news is basically flashing in the newspaper since last couple of days. So you must understand, the bird flu have been reported, right, among various types of birds, especially in the few states. For example, Himachal Pradesh, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, and Kerala, right? So here, the different type of birds have been infected because of this flu. For example, the word flu, which is a common name, is infecting the diverse nature of the birds. For example, the geese are infected, or the wild geese are infected in the Himachal Pradesh. The crows means kauwa, the crows are infected in the Rajasthan. Okay, and in the Madhya Pradesh also the crows are infected. The ducks are infected in Kerala. All right, so these birds are basically infected because of this bird flu. And in Haryana, around 1 lakh poultry bird have already died under mysterious circumstances. All right, so here you must understand, it is under investigation why this 1 lakh poultry birds have died in the mysterious circumstances. It may be because of this bird flu. So bird flu, which is also known as avian influenza, it is basically contagious viral disease. So viral means it is caused because of virus, and it is contagious means it can spread very fast, right? So it is a contagious viral disease, which is caused by influenza type A virus, right? Which generally affect the poultry birds, such as chickens, turkey, geese, right? So they are basically badly affected by this influenza type A virus, which is also the highly contagious viral disease. And you must also understand, just like a COVID-19, this virus or influenza type A virus also has many strains of virus, right? And some of those virus or some of those strains are mild, right? And these mild virus may cause negative implications on the development of egg production, right? Some symptoms, right? Mild symptoms among the chickens, geese, and also some of those strains are also very severe, and some of those strains are also lethal, which cause the death of this poultry, the geese, crows, and etc. ducks in the Kerala. All right, so there are various strains of this the virus, which is also known as influenza type A virus. And and you must understand, there are few words which are reservoir of this virus, which is also known as influenza type A virus. So the mostly the wild aquatic words, just like it ducks and the geese, are the reservoir of this influenza type A virus. And you must understand, it is basically spread from these ducks, right? So it is a central player, or they are the central players in the ecology of these virus. So they basically, there in the ducks and the geese as a natural reservoir of this virus in the worlds, all right? And it basically spread from them, right? And get into the history of the bird flu or influenza type A virus among the humans. So first of all, in 1997, right, the humans were first known to have contacted bird flu, right? Such type of aviation influenza was occurred in a bird market of Hong Kong, right? It was basically an H5N1 strain of virus. So it was first time the human was infected, or human was known to be contracted of this bird flu, right? So it was human which was contracted with the bird flu in 1997 in Hong Kong, right? And you must also understand, subsequently the research basically done on this virus, and it was found that several other strains of the virus, right? This is the one strain which is known as H5N1. There are another strain of the virus like H5N2, H9N2, right? Which also spread from animal to the human. Because here the spreading was occur in the bird market, so definitely it would have spread from either geese, from turkey, or from the chicks to the humans. So here the scientific community have concluded that the another strains of the virus like H5N2 and H9N2 would have spread from animals to the humans, right? And thus it was cause of concern for the global health. And does it spread easily to the humans? This is the question which is coming in your mind also. So first of all, it does not spread easily to the humans. First of all, you must understand, right? Generally, the people which is coming, in the contact or infected with this virus, right? You must understand, they are basically, those birds are basically either alive or dead birds. they would have already contracted this H5N1 bird flu, right? And this usually does not spread from person to person. So first of all, the first thing you must understand, the spread from animals to human, the spread from animals to human is scientifically proved that from animals to human, it is well contracted. But the human to human transmission is not possible, right, among this bird flu. So that is why it does not usually spread from person to person. So that is why it is not a cause of concern for the people who are thinking that this bird flu can be spread from people to people. And there is also no evidence, right, that if the people who are even eating this no turkey, chickens, those who are lovers of eating chickens, no, they don't have to worry about this chicken and all sort of things, because if you properly cook and if you properly, you know, wash the infected, you know, food. First of all, don't eat during that pandemic if there is really a cause of concern for the killing of these birds. And even if you have, right, make sure that the chicken you are having is basically properly cleaned and properly cooked, right? And this virus is basically sensitive to the heat and dry. And if you cook them properly, it dies in the cooking temperature, right? So there is no cause of concern. So two things you must understand. There is a scientific evidence that this virus is basically, you know, is basically spreading from the contaminated or from infected, you know, the chicken or poultry to the humans, and there is no human to human transmission, right? It does not usually spread, so there is no cause of panic. And moreover, it is heat sensitive, so it can die if you cook well, right? The chicken, the geese or turkey, anything you eat at your home, all right? So it is basically a poster you can see here. It is basically, as I told you, the natural reservoir is basically duck, turkey or basically your poultry, right? So here you have the subtypes. The subtypes are basically the hemagglutinin, which is also known as in the short form HA, and neuraminidase, which is also known as NA, right? So here the virus is basically divided into two subtypes, which is known as HA and NA, right? On the basis of the two proteins on the surface of virus. So these two proteins which are found on the surface of the virus, it is basically divided into two subtypes, right? And regarding the HA type subtypes, there are 18 such known HA subtypes which are found. And regarding this neuraminidase, 11 known NA subtypes are also found, right? So based on the different combinations, you can basically find the different type of strain. For example, you have H1N5, you have H7N2 virus, you have H5N1 virus. So it is based on the different combinations, you would have the different strain of this virus. For example, there are 9 known subtypes of H5 virus. So where you have the H5N1, H5N2, H5N3, H5N4, these are all strains of the virus which is known to occur in the wild geese, turkeys, and the poultries, right? So they are basically the natural reservoirs of this virus. Okay, and it is contagious also. It spread very fast among the birds, but the human to human transmission is generally not found, right? But the animal to human transmission can be there. Okay. Let's understand the second news, that is vertical and the horizontal reservations. So I hope you people knows about the reservation system in India. So in India, the Indian constitution provides the reservation based on the population, right? For example, it is based on, first of all, the scheduled caste have been given the reservation based on their population, right? At each state. For example, let's say in the Uttar Pradesh, the scheduled caste population is 21%, right? So 21% reservation for the scheduled caste is given in the Uttar Pradesh. Say in the Rajasthan, the population is 16%. So only 16% reservation is given to the scheduled caste. And if you go to the Punjab, there is a population called 31%, or more than 31% population belongs to the scheduled caste. So around 31% of the seats are reserved for the scheduled caste. So it's based on the population figure of a particular state. But at the central level, the reservation is based on the overall population of the community in when you compare throughout the country, right, or throughout the India. Now, the point here is coming with regard to the vertical and the horizontal reservation. So let's classify this reservation into vertical and the horizontal reservation. So first of all, let's understand the news, then we'll understand what is horizontal reservation and what is vertical reservation. So now the Supreme Court basically, you know, clarified the law, which is basically, you know, led to or which is basically interplaying with the vertical and the horizontal reservations, right? And it is basically the Supreme Court is delivering the verdict on the Suresh Saurav Yadav versus the state of Uttar Pradesh, right? Which is basically dealing with the issue arising from the way the different classes of the reservation were to be applied in the selection process to fill the post of constables, right? So you have the different classes of the reservation which is provided. For example, you have the scheduled caste, you have scheduled tribe, you have other backward classes. You have also the transgender, right? You have also another type of like woman reservation is also there. So different classes of the reservation is provided, right, to fill various posts in your state, right? Here the case is basically the state of Uttar Pradesh. So first of all, let's understand what is vertical reservation. Okay, so vertical reservation, you must understand, right? You have the separate groups. You have the separate groups. For example, you have the scheduled caste. It is a one group. You have the scheduled tribe. It is a one group. You have other backward class. It is a third group, right? And you have also general. You have also general, isn't it? So you have the separate group. But for general, there is no reservation. It is open. It is open. So here, if you classify the population into particular groups, you're getting my point. If you are classifying the population in a particular group, and for that group, if you are providing the reservation, that comes under vertical reservation. That comes under vertical reservation. That means it is basically group wise specification of the population and providing the reservation. It is known as the vertical reservation system. Okay. Now, what is the horizontal reservation? Right? Horizontal reservation means you are nothing but providing the equal opportunity, right, to you know, to other categories of the beneficiaries also, right? For example, if there are women, the women will be placing in the scheduled caste also, right? The women are there, for example, in transgender community. The women are there, for example, in the other backward class also. The women are also there in the scheduled tribe also. So you are ultimately providing the equal opportunities, right, to other categories of the beneficiaries also, right? And such categories may be the women witnesses, right? Such categories may be transgender communities. Such categories may be the individuals which have the disabilities like physically handicapped, right? Which are basically cutting through this vertical categories. So such type of reservation system would be called as a horizontal reservation system. And you must understand the horizontal quota is applied separately to each vertical category. And that is not across the abroad. All right. So, and you must also understand that what the Supreme Court basically held, that the interlocking of these two types of reservation, right, basically has led to a lot of questions in the mind of the people, right? For example, would an SC woman would be put in the category of woman or SC? For example, if you see basically the Panchayati Raj system, where the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act has led to the reservation of at least one third of the seats reserved for the women. Okay. Now the question is coming that the SC women, if their seats are reserved, for example, one third seats are reserved, okay, for the women at the panchayat level, at every panchayat level, it is throughout the country. But you must understand, if that among the women, SC woman is also there, ST woman is also there, OBC woman is also there, but there is no reservation for the other backward class. There is a reservation for the SC, there is a reservation for ST, right? Now, if you are classifying further, the woman comes in the SC also, the woman comes in the ST also, it is there in the OBC also, it is there in the ST. So, what would you do, whether you would classify the SC woman in the category of the woman or category of SC? So, in the Panchayati Raj system, there is a clear demarcation that the woman seats are one third reserved in favor of only women, and the remaining seat may be filled by the other, you know, by the other people. For example, the male can come on other seats, but one third seats will be filled only through the woman. But here the question is arising whether the SC woman is considered in the category of only woman or SC. This is the question. So that classification needs certain clarification, because if you are giving the reservation to the woman, right, for example, in the Rajasthan, in the Rajasthan, if you say, in the Rajasthan state, 25% reservation is given to the girls. Okay. So 25% reservation is given to the girls. But if you say the overall seats of for scheduled caste, for example, there is a 16% reservation. Only 16% reservation for the scheduled caste. And for the scheduled tribe, there is a 12% reservation. But that 25% of the seats of which is basically reserved for the women, that is when you compare the seats out of total seats, isn't it? For example, there are 100 seats. You have to give 25 seats to the women. That 25 seats also include the woman belongs to the SC. That 25 seats also include the woman belongs to the ST. So that include not only the horizontal reservation, but also the vertical reservation also, isn't it? So that woman is not a simple woman, but that woman is also belongs to the scheduled caste category also. So SC woman would definitely a woman, but that comes in the scheduled caste category also. All right. So that is how the question which is flashing in the newspaper. Okay. Let's move to the new news. That is magnetotelluric. Magneto, right? Magnetotelluric. So what is that magnetotelluric? So which is basically a geophysical survey. Okay. It is a geophysical survey, which is also known as the magnetotelluric, which is basically conducted over the Delhi region, right? So it is a survey which is conducted. So here you must understand the national capital region of Delhi experienced the four small earthquakes during April up to August 2020. So first of all, you must understand the Delhi comes under zone 4 of the seismicity zones, right? If you divide our country into different type of seismic zones, the Delhi comes under the seismic zone 4. And every year, the Delhi experience various magnitudes of the earthquakes, right? But that is not that much big, right? So these small earthquakes that occur every year, because it comes under the category of zone 4, on the category of zone 4, when you compare the zones based on the seismicity, right? Based on the magnitude it can come of the earthquakes. So here, the dozens of the micro events occur that is less than magnitude of 3, right? So which is also related to the few aftershocks which generally followed after an earthquakes, right? And all these events are located by the National Seismological Network, right? This network is basically operated and maintained by the National Seismological Center, which is basically under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. So it is a survey which is conducted by the Ministry of Earth Sciences, right, with the government of India to find out basically make the pattern of these, the small earthquakes and the aftershocks, which basically comes in the Delhi and the nearby Delhi region. So it is basically a survey, geophysical survey, which is also known as magnetotelluric survey. And subsequently, this National Seismological Center initiated this survey, which is also known as the magnetotelluric survey, right, over the Delhi region. This survey is basically carried out with an institute which is also known as the Wadia Institute for the Himalayan Geology, which is located in Dehradun. So it is a method or it is a survey which will basically use the natural time variation of earth magnetic and the electric fields, right? So it is basically to understand the geological structure and the process. Okay, the geological structure means the structure which is below the earth surface or below the ground. So where the survey will basically study the underground structure, right? Underground structure, and it will also check the strain level, right? It will also check the different type of fault which may be there below the earth surface. For example, the different type of measurement will be conducted under this survey, which is also known as magnetotelluric survey. This measurements will be conducted across the major seismic zones. For example, these major seismic zones are basically namely at the Mahendragarh Dehradun fault, Sohna fault, and Mathura fault. Right, Mathura fault, right? So these are basically faults. So what are the faults? These faults are nothing but the zone of weakness. They are the zones of weakness. So where the earthquakes can come through this fault. So here, the overall study would actually, the overall, you know, the survey would study these faults or these seismic sources. From there, the earthquakes usually occur in the Delhi region, right? And it will also check or to ascertain the presence of fluid, right? Which basically enhance the possibility of triggering this earthquakes in the Delhi region. So it is basically this type of fault which is basically occurred, but it is not visible. It is not visible. It is one such fault which is visible in the earthquakes. If you see, you know, for example, in the San Francisco earthquakes in the USA, which also caused the dislocation of the land as well as the formation of this fault. So San Andreas earthquakes also related to this, you know, fault type of features. So in the Delhi also, you have the different type of fault. This fault is basically the zone of weakness where all along this fault, a tremendous energy is released. And these faults are located at Mahendragarh, Dehradun fault, Sohna fault, and Mathura fault. Through this, the underground vibrations and underground energy is released and causing the earthquakes, right, in the Delhi region. All right. Let's understand the next news, that is double stack long haul container train operation. So double stack. Okay. So double stack means you have the two double stack long haul container train means it won't stop. It won't stop for the shorter period of the time, but it will be, you know, operating for the longer distance and it will be a container train, right? So it is related to the container train, which does not have the short haul, but it is also the long haul and it is basically a double track long haul container train. All right. So let's understand, on the 7th January 2021, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi will flag off the world's first double-decker stack long-haul train. So it is basically the double-decker. Double-decker ka matlab hota hai, ek dabbe ke upar dusra dabba hoga. Jaise double-decker train chal rahi hai, aapki dekhiye India mein, you have on from in between Jaipur to Delhi. See, if you visit Delhi, you go to Delhi. If you visit Delhi, and if you want to go to Jaipur, right, you will have the train that is called double decker train. So that is double decker. So you will have the one train bogie, and after that you will have another train bogie, right? So you will have double decker, just like a double decker bus. So like that, you will have double decker or double stack, you know, train that will be hauled by the electric traction. And one such first double decker traction would be, you know, would be hauled by the electric traction, and that will be originated from the new Ateli to new Kishangarh, right? So that will be originated from new Ateli to new Kishangarh. And this double stack long haul container train will have the enhanced axle load of 25 tons. So there is some, you know, the technical specification that we need not to worry about. So here the axle load, the specification is 25 tons. And it is designed by, you know, by first of all, the RDSO's wagon department. Okay, the trial run of such wagons have been already completed. Okay, which has already completed. Now this will basically flagged off on 7th of January 2021 by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And this design will ultimately maximize, you know, the capacity utilization and overall the point loading, which will also enhance the capacity of Indian Railways to carry, you know, the goods to across, you know, different stations. And that will carry the four times, right? You know, that can carry basically four times as much as weight it can carry by the simple train. All right. So it is basically the double, you know, the stack goods train. All right. Next, the new Rewari, new mother station of WDFC. So it is basically WDFC means Western Dedicated Freight Corridor. So here, the new section of Western Dedicated Freight Corridor, right, have been dedicated to the nation by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So the news which is basically related to the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor. So here, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi will dedicate the nation of a separate section under the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor. So this separate section is known as the new Rewari, new mother section, which will be coming under the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor on 7th of January 2021. So this stretch of the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor have been dedicated to the nation by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and it is of 306 kilometers long. So it is a section in the dedicated freight corridor, which is the Western dedicated freight corridor, which will connect the new Rewari and new Mother section, which will be situated in the Haryana, and that will have approximately the 79 kilometers in the Mahendragarh and the Rewari districts, and that will pass around 227 kilometers in the Rajasthan. Right, in the Rajasthan, it will pass through Jaipur, Ajmer, Sikar, Nagaur, and Alwar districts. All right. So this section of the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor, which will be mainly there in Haryana for 79 kilometers and Rajasthan for 227 kilometers. All right. And it is a part of the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor, which will be dedicated to the nation, right, by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And it will consisting of the 9 newly built up the dedicated freight corridor stations, right, where it will be having certain loading and unloading type of phenomena. So this 9 newly dedicated freight stations are basically the new Davla, the new Bagega, the new Sri Savai, new Sri Madhapur, right, new Pachar Malikpur, the new Sakun, the new Kishangarh, while other 3 stations are new Rewari, new Ateli, and new Fulera, which are the junction stations. And through these junction stations, it will be connected on this Western Dedicated Freight Corridor. All right. So it is basically a picture of the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor. All right. Let's understand the new news, that is Kamdhenu Gau Vigyan Prachar Prasar Exam. Okay. So it is, you know, you must understand the Rashtriya Kamdhenu Aayog, which have recently been set up by the government of India, right? This Rashtriya Kamdhenu Aayog has announced the Kamdhenu Gau Vigyan Prachar Prasar Exam, right? So here you must understand the Kamdhenu Study Center or the Kamdhenu Chair, right, which was established, right, in all colleges and the universities across the country, is getting countrywide momentum. So the establishment of this Kamdhenu Chair or Kamdhenu Study Center or Kamdhenu Research Center, which will be set up in across the colleges and the universities, is getting countrywide momentum, right? So it is a pet product of the BJP, right, the BJP led government, which is basically propagating the Kamdhenu Vigyan Prachar Prasar Exam, right, for raising the mass awareness about the indigenous cows, right, among the students and every other citizens. This Ramdhenu or this Rashtriya Kamdhenu Aayog is basically doing the study, you know, or making the study materials about the cow science, right, which is available, and conducting this cow, Kamdhenu Gau Vigyan Prachar Prasar examination to benefit the students, right, especially the young students and other citizens also. And it will definitely infuse, the different type of curiosity into the minds of the people about the cows. And it will also make them aware about this unexplored exploitation of the cows, right, related to the cow dung, cow milk, right? So it will also have certain type of opportunities, like business opportunities, right? And it will also have certain other opportunities to have the scientific, the research on the milk and on the urine and all such byproducts of cow, isn't it? And this exam, which is also known as the Kamdhenu Gau Vigyan Prachar Prasar Exam, will be an online exam, right? And it will be conducted throughout the country on 25th February 2021, right? This exam will be an annual event of Rashtriya Kamdhenu Aayog in the future, and that will basically boost the curiosity in the minds of, the people about the cows, and make them also aware about this unexplored, potential in the field of, the indigenous cows. All right, students. So thank you very much for this. That's all for the today. And we'll meet again tomorrow. Thank you very much.